And this is where, you know, it starts to get a little bit disturbing if you think about language not as being even a communication system, but an operating system. What language is meant to do is to make people do things. And it is this shared cultural artifact. It doesn't, it's, let's face it, it's downloaded in against your will without, you don't sign a waiver before you sign up.
It's too late. By the time you're reading the waiver, it's too late.
Yeah, you don't get to click, you know, permission to right? Exactly. And so, you know, every baby from before they're born in utero is already being conditioned and language is being downloaded into them. And now we know, in a way we didn't know before, that it is this kind of its own self-running system. It's a product of society, not of any individual. And it's a product that society didn't design except in an emergent way. People didn't, you know, we don't think, I don't think neither of us thinks, either of us thinks that, you know, a bunch of, you know, very clever people got together and said, how are we going to control the populace? We need to design this system that's going to run in them. And it's far stranger than that. But yet at the same time, it isn't really of us individually, it is society. And so things like beliefs, you know, society itself, it's built up of all these notions that are language dependent, and they're running in us and they make us go. You know, you get up in the morning because you got to go to your job, because you got to make money, because you you know, you have to have a certain degree of prestige in the world, and you're going to have to, you know, one day you're going to get older, and all of these things. Animals don't know any of these things, right? Who put these ideas in our minds? Well, forget about who, but how. And the answer is language. And so there is this thing that's in us, but not really of us, that is running, and it's driving most of our behavior. Those are the things we do.
Who's familiar with this idea of jailbreaking a language model, right? So there's things they won't do or don't want to do, but if you're very clever about how you ask for it, you can get it to kind of leak out that information. Are we subject to that same kind of vulnerability? And I would suspect and suggest that we are, and that we need to be aware of this. This kind of prompt engineering or prompt hacking is probably something that's been happening since the beginning of civilization, but we didn't have any kind of meta awareness. And I think the most interesting thing in development about these AI models in general is how they're going to affect our mind, how they're going to change how we think about our language, our words, our cognition, our place in the universe. They're giving us this. It's not quite a magnifying glass. I call it the macroscope, because it's showing us the big picture all at once. And it might be a terrifying view that it's opening up.
Even more potentially disturbingly, we now have, now that we've captured not just language, but in some ways culture and thought in a system that we can manipulate and test. Mm-hmm. Doesn't that potentially give people, and maybe even people with ill intent, the opportunity to see what's effective in changing minds, what's effective in manipulating people's thoughts?
That's a really great point you bring up, because now that you have a sort of a simulated person in a jar, you can test it. You can sort of A-B testing, right? Will they respond to this? Will they respond to that? And kind of simulate the attack a million times and then go test that sentence out. This is what scammers do. When they finally get people on the call, they have a script, and that script is very like honed in. They've evolved that script over years, potentially, and the ones that get the scam, that determines the script that survives. So in that same kind of thing, are we susceptible to those kind of, and are they just spontaneous? Is a lot of the things we see in culture, these spontaneities, these scripts that take off and go viral, and we communicate them, but we're actually hacking each other in ways we don't really understand.
But now we can run, you know, as you said, it took years to develop. And, you know, the car salesman and all of that.
Yeah, yeah.
These have been honed over, you know, many, many generations.
Now you can do it at high speed.
Now we can do it at high speed.
Yeah.
You know, in silicon, like, boom. run the experiment. And you've just tested out 100,000 customers under these varying different conditions. Is this a good thing?
Or is this an information hazard?
Is God just a token?
Quite. When you say just a token, so let's have respect for these tokens, right? Because what they really are these, you know, almost like informational angels or something that do all of this stuff within the larger context, not only in language, but in our behavior, in the ecosystem, the larger social ecosystem. What is God in that system? And the answer in my case, it would be, well, maybe it doesn't point, the same way that red doesn't really point to that cup. But what does it point to? It's not pointing in the traditional sense, but it's doing stuff. If we think of an operating system, what does God do in our operating system? What does the token God do in our operating system? And then you have a completely different perspective. It's not about an ontology of like, does it point to some divine being, whatever that would mean. And, you know, when you try to define God, it all becomes, it falls apart in your fingers. But what does God do in the minds of people? Well, I think we have actually some good ideas about what that idea does. Is maybe that idea itself almost synonymous with what people mean by it? Now that's where things get really interesting.
You can imagine a God so powerful, he need not actually exist.
Exactly.
And something we talk about a lot, it's, you know, my thoughts are not your thoughts kind of a thing. And another joke that we follow up with, it's the thoughts that do the thinking. So if I were to phrase it, is God just a story? And if so, would that make him any less powerful? Right? And I think what you're suggesting is it's real. And I would say it's real like software, right? Facebook's just software. It's not real. There's no actual physical entity called Facebook. I don't mean the headquarters. I mean like the thing that we log into or whatever. But it's real. I don't think anyone would argue that things like large software platforms or even markets or societies, you can't pin them down. Be like, well, what is Toronto? Is it that thing? Right? No, it's somehow weirder than that, but doesn't make it any less real, right?
Well, there's a difference here between God as one traditionally conceptualizes it, whatever that means, and then God as just a story that has effects on people. Now, if the broader sweep of people believed God was just a story that happened to have effects, that would also have its own effect, separate from the traditional conceptualization.
So wouldn't the first and second be the same thing? So I call this third order religious, right? First order religious is just sort of, it's just true, it's real, it's out there. You don't really question or worry about it. Second order would be, well, it has utility. It helps a lot of people. It's a very powerful, you know, collective force. And I would argue what I call the third order is to realize those first two are the same thing. It doesn't make it any less powerful or majestic or divine or inspirational or transcendent, maybe even more so, because we now see how it sort of bootstraps into reality.
Yeah, one way to think about this is getting outside just of a sort of the very limited space of thinking about physical reality as impinging on our senses and causing these behaviors, but that the universe broadly is kind of reflected in these patterns that are taking place in our brain. And then you just have to do a quick little switcheroo. If we call the physical universe, and maybe the physical universe is an instantiation of, you know, some sort of Platonic informational space, well, let's just call that God. And then what has happened here is that is actually molded this particular system that's talking about itself in some very, very real sense.
Or constructing itself, even.
Or constructing itself.
Just a moment. Don't go anywhere. Hey, I see you inching away. Don't be like the economy. Instead, read The Economist. I thought all The Economist was something that CEOs read to stay up to date on world trends. And that's true, but that's not only true. What I found more than useful for myself, personally, is their coverage of math, physics, philosophy, and AI, especially how something is perceived by other countries and how it may impact markets. For instance, The Economist had an interview with some of the people behind DeepSeek the week DeepSeek was launched. No one else had that. Another example is The Economist has this fantastic article on the recent dark energy data, which surpasses even Scientific American's coverage, in my opinion. They also have the chart of everything. It's like the chart version of this channel. It's something which is a pleasure to scroll through and learn from. Links to all of these will be in the description, of course. Now, The Economist's commitment to rigorous journalism means that you get a clear picture of the world's most significant developments. I am personally interested in the more scientific ones, like this one on extending life via mitochondrial transplants, which creates actually a new field of medicine, something that would make Michael Levin proud. The Economist also covers culture, finance and economics, business, international affairs, Britain, Europe, the Middle East, Africa, China, Asia, the Americas, and of course, the USA. Whether it's the latest in scientific innovation or the shifting landscape of global politics, The Economist provides comprehensive coverage, and it goes far beyond just headlines. Look, if you're passionate about expanding your knowledge and gaining a new understanding, a deeper one, of the forces that shape our world, then I highly recommend subscribing to The Economist. I subscribe to them, and it's an investment into my, into your intellectual growth. It's one that you won't regret. As a listener of this podcast, you'll get a special 20% off discount. Now you can enjoy The Economist and all it has to offer for less. Head over to their website, www.economist.com/toe, T-O-E, to get started. Thanks for tuning in. And now let's get back to the exploration of the mysteries of our universe. Again, that's economist.com/toe.